August 8th, 1983, my life changed for the better. Bobby came along. He got released from the hospital the next day, which was my dad's birthday. Bobby was definitely a puke baby. He had a habit of throwing up quite often, and for some reason people had the habit of like holding him up over their head and shaking him, and well, his dad got a mouthful, and then once again my girlfriend got a mouthful.
Bobby was the guy that could figure it out one way or another. There was always something that was the issue, and he could look it up, go through something, figure it out. Whether it was mechanical, if he couldn't do it, he'd find somebody that could and get it accomplished one way or another. He never really stopped. He might pause, but he wouldn't quit doing that.
Bobby started getting into mechanics of things. Once tore apart my living room clock just to see what was on the inside, what made the hands move, and how come they were so slow, and how could he make them faster. So we tried to keep him away from the VCR, kitchen appliances.
Do you remember the first time I met him? I don't remember the first time I met him. My entire life he had always been there. My entire life.
I met Bobby when I moved to Arlington in 1998 from Snohomish. She's one of my first friends. And we hit it off because he was such a personality that anyone could adapt to instantly.
As a child, he was very inquisitive. Like I say, he didn't really like school, but he seemed to learn well on his own. He was a daredevil from day one. One thing that I really admired about him was he really loved his brothers. I remember when TJ was just a tiny baby and he'd go upstairs to take his nap, Bobby would sit on the staircase playing with cars or whatever, just waiting for TJ to wake up so he could play with them or watch Ghostbusters with him.
Bobby was one of the most unique people I've ever met in my life. There wasn't anything that he did that a normal person could think of.
He was candle at both ends, burning with gasoline dripping on the wick. That's Bobby.
Bobby was the first person that I thought got me, because I wasn't into cars or music or a lot of the stuff that most of his friends were. We always just saw eye to eye on everything. There was never something that me and Bobby disagreed on or couldn't come to an agreement on, and I haven't had many friends that were like that.
Bobby, everything.
Bobby was the DIY master. That motherfucker would do the craziest shit ever imagined.
I remember Bobby when I was in about first grade in Trafton, and that was one of the tiniest schools, and so all the portables were smaller grades, first kindergarten, and you had to go into the big building to go to the bathroom. I met Bobby because he was the guy who'd go like this in the doorway and wouldn't let me pass. Big guy. And I was scared to death of him that whole year. I had to jump between his legs and run.
Well, he's been lit on fire more than once.
Bobby walked in. It was like my NJD's second date. And I had this big 32-ounce mocha. And he's like, that looks really good. You want some of my mocha? And he's like, yeah. And I gave him this 32-ounce mocha breve. And he chugged the entire thing. He chugged the whole thing to the bottom. And then handed me back ice and was like, there you go. I was like, dude, you can have the ice.
I'll never forget Bobby for all the laughs. Sincerely. Dry heaving, like what is happening right now? Just the random stream of consciousness messages he was sending me at all hours of the night. I don't think Bobby ever slept.
Dude, you see Bobby, you know you're in for a good time. That in essence was Bobby, just doing whatever. It didn't matter what it was.
I remember Bobby being the guy who was the life of the party but didn't even have a drink in his hand or didn't even smoke weed and thought we were all nerds for needing booze and weed to have fun, you know? Because he could do it without.
I don't know if you can see it, but there's bird shit all over it. It's the simple things in life.
One of the first times we hung out and we took the diplomat, he wanted to go to one of his favorite places, Pole Apart. So Matt and I go because we'd recently heard that you can take chunks of spark plugs and throw them at windows.
Oh, yeah.
And shatter them.
Watching him build that diplomat year after year, it changed, especially after high school. But even during high school, it really had a morph in personality once he took shop class and he learned how to weld. And I remember he put this big cow catcher on there. I just remember the shop teacher Van looking at him just shaking his head some days with some of the stuff that Bobby was putting together in shop class and physically attaching to the car. And he eventually figured out how to get a PA system on there, and I remember going up and down State Street in Marysville with him blasting music, and he had a spotlight at one point just picking people out.
The CB radio in the Dodge Diplomat, and I'd never actually gotten to use one. And I remember cruising around with Bobby and Matt, and he had the Knight Rider theme song and holding that thing up to the speakers and playing that, driving through town, causing hell. I don't know how many times everybody got to hear that. I couldn't get enough of it. He eventually took the speaker away from me.
Genius plans. He had 50,000 projects that were absolutely amazing, and not one of them ever got finished.
I remember him writing the story, and I don't think a lot of people literally remember it, because I always kept on telling him, I was like, dude, you need to finish this story. The story was pink soup for breakfast. And the whole concept was this family that was in this old home, and they had lead pink paint on the walls, and they'd scrape it off the walls and put it into this bowl. And I don't remember if there was water in it or whatever. It might have been milk or some shit. And that's what they'd eat. So we literally called the story Pink Soup for Breakfast. And I was like, dude, this is f***ing great. The best part of that story was, so the family, for some reason, were on, it was a f***ing plane. And they're up, I think, doing the vertical climb. And one of the family members literally sees someone they know that happened to have been named Jack. And in the story, they literally are saying, hi, Jack, loud as f***. Like, everybody in there was like, oh, shit, the plane's getting hijacked. And it's just like, what the f***, dude? And just listening to all these weird little things pertaining to that story, I'm just like, that was such a great story. And I'm like, I don't know if he ever finished it. And damn it if he didn't, but that motherfucker was working on so many damn things.
Probably rambled a bit.
Bobby was nothing but enigmatic energy. He was nothing but ideas and inspiration and originality.
We're here to fuck shit up.
He would come to JD and say, dude, I have this idea.
Be scared when he says, I have an idea.
Yeah. And it was Bobby's brains, but JD's mechanics. And together, those two, they did the headless, they did that stove. He worked on the flaming scooter numerous times. They did the dippy together. They built a Cadillac together. Bobby would come over and they would just make random things. So most of my memories with Bobby are party memories, because most of the time I was just giving the men their space in the garage and or feeding Bobby. Bobby would come over for dinner 3 times a week at one point. Just, hey man, how are you off? We cook too much, come over. And he'd come over and he'd just hang out and he'd overstay his welcome a little bit, but then he'd mosey on home. Or he didn't, because he stayed the night a lot.
No, wherever he's at, he's got that headless, you know? And it's not like the headless goes up there and grows a head. No, it's going to stay headless.
Him and JD had just finished the headless guitar, and we were going to barter fair. And Bobby took this headless guitar on barter fair and played it for everybody. He joined in every drum circle and every jam sesh he could get into. He was in there, and he was playing this headless guitar, and everybody were like, wait, dude, is that a headless guitar? And he'd explain, yeah, man, I just threw it together. And he would play it, and everybody there was so amazed, and we were leaving, and all Bobby could do was say on the whole way home, like, I really have something. Like, did you guys see the reaction? Like, this guitar is amazing. Like, this is my shit. And he was so proud of that guitar.
That was my guitar. We, one summer, that was probably the best summer with him. We'd all go to his Aunt Marcy's house, and we'd always just jam out back, smoke, drink. Nothing but fun. And I set my guitar down. We were talking, yada yada. Then the dog Buddy walked by it, brushed by it, fell over. The head came clean off. I was like, it's my guitar. Yeah, just shattered right in front of me, basically. Bobby's like, whoa, 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 calm down. Like, it's okay. I can fix it. And him and JD worked their asses off on it. Fucking thing played beautifully.
He just didn't give a shit and just said, no, I'm gonna try it. I'm gonna do it. You know?
First experience at drifting, he must have been probably about 3 years old. He was at my mom's house on the big wheel. Once he learned how to do little Brodies out in her yard and stuff, we ended up going through big wheel tires almost monthly, because that was his thing. That's what he liked to do. So he would be out there spinning the tires on the big wheel. So he started this at an early age.
But I remember we used to be in the Diplomat, and I'd be like, oh, we're pushing the limits. Let's slow it down, let's not die.
And he was drifting, I was his spotter, as he was going through kind of just the outskirts of a neighborhood. Bought this corner, watch what I'm gonna do. And he comes flying around probably 40 miles an hour and kicking dirt and dust and rocks everywhere. And we're on our way home back to Arlington proper. And we're driving down 530 by the Trafton store, and we're going 60 miles an hour. And all of a sudden, he just beelined off of this dirt path. rocks kicking everywhere. But what you don't see in the video is a huge plume, huge, gigantic dirt plume that enveloped the entire gas station. And I remember as we're driving by, I saw one guy, he's like, oh no. And just as we drove by, the whole gas station got covered in dirt.
The craziest thing I've ever witnessed Bobby do was shit in my cousin's purse at the wedding.
I think we all know the purse story. It was my wedding.
Bobby was playing and he was just jamming at the reception. And my cousin's wife was super drunk and she made some really sideways remarks.
Said he was gonna be great if he wasn't so fat.
And she ended up getting kicked out of the reception by one of my other friends who ended up messing up her ankle, chasing after Becca to get her to leave the reception because everybody had Bobby's back and they're like, you're not cool, you gotta fucking go. Bobby, we have you. She left her purse. And Bobby took the purse and there was like two bags of drugs in there and credit cards and her cell phone and all sorts of other just things that a girl keeps in her purse. And Bobby took it and he took it overnight. And the next day he came back and he told me and JD what he was gonna do with it. And he wasn't gonna give it back to her. Like, dude, you can't do that. That's my family. You cannot take her purse. And he was like, yeah, you're right. And he kind of paused for a second and he looked at me, he's dead in the eyes, and he said, I'm gonna shit in it though.
And well, Bobby got his hands on her purse and shit in it.
All right, as long as you give it back, dude. So he did. He shit in the purse.
And then the word got around to me that that had happened. And so I was like, fuck it, Bobby. I'm shitting in the purse too.
I wasn't there. I found out later that JD also then took it upon himself to shit on Bobby's shit. So JD was in the bathroom, squatted over. This tiny, it was like a handbag. It wasn't like a big boho purse. It was this tiny little, she was going to a wedding and needed to carry her stuff purse. So JD had to squat over it in the bathroom. He ended up puking three times while he was pooping on Bobby's poop.
I puked three times doing it, smelling Bobby's shit, but I shit that goddamn purse too.
And then about a week later, my cousin contacted me and he was like, hey, you know, we need Becca's purse. She left it at the wedding reception. And I was like, Jason, man, it's been tainted. Like, remember Bobby? He pooped in it. And so he requested that we get the debit cards and the cell phone out of the purse.
A few days later, I had to dig through it and get the goddamn debit card and cell phone out.
So JD had to then go back and dig through their poops to get Becca's stuff out of her purse.
I at first I thought they were kidding, man. Like, who actually shits in somebody's purse? Fucking Bobby does.
He was all about the laugh. He was all about, hey, let's have a, you know, and hey, let's have a good time.
He always had his funny songs and stuff like that that he played, but was probably the first time that I saw him play some of his music at the Mirkwood, and the people's reactions to Bobby that had never seen him or met him before, was that was funnier than Bobby. It was the people, the way people react to Bobby that don't get Bobby, you know, the way that they, that everyone is so freaked out by him until they get to know him and then they fall in love with him.
God, I love that guy.
25th birthday, we started rallying around the tracks. And it ended up blowing the tire off the bead. We got drunk and lost the key. And it's parked in the middle of the yard. And so the thing's broken down in the yard the whole night. We started in the afternoon and it's like 5 in the morning. And the party's dwindling down and we are pretty banged up. And we decide it was a good idea to flip the truck over. And then Bobby looks over and he's like, we could light it on fire.
He was crawling out of the upturned car in the middle of a field at night. And just immediately went to chug a pitcher of beer.
And so I think Matt got up on top of it and started pouring gas on it and just whew, and it went up.
But it was fire and it was Bobby, and yeah, that's just what he did. He's like, hey.
I always carried around a pair of boxing gloves in my car, and Bobby get feisty sometimes, and so, all right, let's go get the gloves. Maybe I was the one getting feisty, I don't know.
The one time he sliced his stomach open with a pair of pipe cutters, and granted, I didn't see it. Well, he ended up grabbing his Gerber, which is his favorite thing in the world, pulling out a glob of fat on his stomach and hucked it. And then he ended up in the hospital with staph infection.
Gotten hurt when he had the slash from the pipe wrench or pipe cutters, spent time in the hospital. When he got out, he lived in a two-story thing upstairs. He couldn't get downstairs, couldn't get out to his car. He racked up numerous parking tickets for not being able to move it. So I just said, you know what, I'm just going to give you the money. Don't pay me back. So when you give somebody money, think, I'm giving them money, and it's done. But Bobby did not like that. He insisted on evening it out, doing something to repay. Well, there was a time that we decided we need to put in a fence around our yard. So I told Bobby, I said, why don't you come on up and I'll have you just clear the fence line. I said, but come on out, I'll show you. I don't want you to cut this tree. And I showed him the other bush. I said, and I don't want you to cut this. You know, those are the only two. Well, so finally he came in and he said, well, I got a surprise for you. You're really going to like this. So I walked out there and about 25 foot in, I'm going, Bobby, where's the tree with the red leaves? He said, oh, well, wasn't that the one you wanted me to cut down? No, there was two of them I did not want you to cut down. He said, all I could remember about those two things, what they were important, and I thought you wanted them to go first. So he wiped out my plants.
When he was 16, I think it was, his dad and I got him a ride in one of the warbirds that he had been talking about. His dad got him a leather coat, and his dad had taken him out for a breakfast at a restaurant. And of course, we all know there's pancakes and heavy stuff. But he got to go up in this plane, and they had him on camera. When he got out of the plane, he literally could hardly walk. He was so shaky. And he did admit, yeah, I almost threw up, Mom, like four times. So that was something great and something that we'll always remember, because he really, really enjoyed that.
When, because of course one of the greatest songs he had was Hooked on Pabst, you know. But the beauty of it, the beauty of that song was, and he literally has said it live. Like the last time I saw him, he literally said it live. It's like, this was recorded in that motherfucker's garage at his mom's house. And I was like, yeah, it was. And it was fucking beautiful.
You could get along with anybody. You could fit into any group.
He had his friends. He wanted his friends to meet his other friends. He wanted to help anybody who needed the help that he could provide.
I think Bobby would be extremely amazed and find so much joy in the fact that everyone's coming together. He had so many different circles that didn't know each other.
We had the fireworks. I bought them. Got a screaming deal. And if anybody ever wondered, the actual pipe itself is an actual PVC pipe. It wasn't like some cardboard can, you know, like just bust open or whatever. And so what happened was, he just came over and he was so far gone at that point. And I had the camera and it wasn't the greatest camera in the world. I mean, you can obviously see it through the video. And I tell you, we were just, you know, doing some shit, and he's just like, hey, I'll put it on my dick and we'll fire it off. I'm like, fuck yeah, let's do it. And thankfully his cousin Will was there, and we set it up and we started going. And I'll tell you, the face that motherfucker had when we lied off that first one, man, and that was the one, just, you know, just him just being, oh my God! I mean, it was so beautiful, man. Just watching him having that experience. And I'm just like, you know, now I think about it, I'm like, damn it, I wish I had the balls for that. I really wish I had the balls for that. And it kills me, because I'm like, damn, that was so fucking good.
It's insane how many people know Bobby and have never even met him, but they know his personality just through the stories we tell.
As far as everyone else, I'm sure they know he was a dog lover, and he would fall asleep in my house and my dogs would end up sleeping on him, and it was pretty awesome. He just loved them. They loved him.
Up to his belly button, yeah, over the foot, man. That's, I can't unsee that.
Fuck.
The under area of the stomach likes to be warm and cozy and moist a little bit. So, you know, over time, some stuff builds up under there and it gets a little smell. And, you know, if you really wanted to just get on Bobby's bad side, you might see and smell what the Foop Nasty was. and it wasn't very pretty.
The only joy he got out of it is that it was heavy. So whenever you stuck something up under it, the weight of the poop would hold it in place. Luckily for me, I have a pretty shitty sense of smell like Bobby. I never smelled him. That's why it was nasty, for sure. And Bobby, it's hard to clean under that. Poop, I mean, fat upper penis area.
The 5-gallon challenge, you know, I watched him drink 5 gallons of Guinness in a night. Just insane kind of shit like that.
5-gallon challenge. He was at Clinton's house, and by that time him and I had become close, and I was kind of maternal instinct and nagged all the guys, don't do this, don't do that, drink your water, everything. He's about halfway through the 5 gallons. Take care of yourself. We don't want you to die with this. And his response to me was, my dick's not in your pussy 5 nights a week, so you have no reason to be nagging me.
And Bobby had 24 hours to drink 5 gallons of Guinness. Mm-hmm. And that guy did it in 14 and drank another 6-pack.
Like, because he was just carrying around a pony keg. Yeah. And anytime anybody ever wanted any of it, he was like, absolutely not. This is mine. Get away from me.
You know, you'll eventually die. Eat yourself into an early death, but I don't think you can masturbate yourself into an early death.
In 34 years, Bob Fletcher managed to cram every ounce of life that at least 50% of the population can't manage in twice or three times that length. They just don't.
I don't think there was a single event that wasn't funny.
He has lived life more than people that are 70 years old in his 34 years.
He's going to be missed. And if you didn't know him, you missed out. You're not gonna find anybody like him. That dude was literally larger than life.
One of those guys that you can't replace. He was literally one of a kind. There's no one else in this world that could do or think the way he did.
He was one in a million. The world will never be the same. And we really miss him, and I love you, Bobby.
I love you, man. I mean, nothing's gonna be the same anymore. If it was anywhere, it would be in a field of fucking dogs. At some fucking hippie festival with a goddamn guitar in his hand and a pound of weed right next to him. And probably a fifth of R&R.
I think he's still keeping an eye on his family, definitely making sure his mom and his brothers and stuff were okay.
It's just the life and the energy that he gave out. He made a really good friend. And I'm sorry to see him gone.
God, he's got to be up there playing music with Blaine and all those guys, you know, hanging out with Vance and Dub, you know. All the guys from Arlington that we've lost over the years, and Bobby's just up there chilling, man.
Right now, honestly, I think he's trying to figure out how to piss on the clouds and make rain. And probably try to figure out how to shit through the clouds, too. Like, you think acid rain's bad.
Bobby's here. I don't know if everybody else can feel him, but Bobby hasn't gone anywhere. I hear Bobby. I don't think any of us will ever let Bobby die. I think he's figuring shit out. I think he knows every question, every answer that he's ever thought of. He knows all the answers now, and he's fucking stoked to be able to harness it and figure out more, because he was so inquisitive, and now he has it all at his fingertips. And I truly believe that if we listen, he'll show us what's up. I really, truly do.
I think Bobby is in spirit. He's still with all of us, of course, but he's definitely with his grandmother, definitely up with some dogs. For some reason, I can't find Charlie's Kong, and I can't help but think he took it with him because there's going to be dogs there that he needs to play with. And, you know, Bobby, when you left, I thought a piece of my heart went with you, but in the last 2 weeks, my heart's grown twice the size because of all the love that everybody had for you. Love you, Bubba.